First up, a new road safety campaign is about to hit TV screens in Victoria following an alarming rise in the state's road toll, which is at a 14-year high. The latest Transport Accident Commission ad targets texting and talking drivers who are now called the new drink drivers. Gav, the message they're sending that if you're on your phone and you're driving, you're basically driving blind, and that's why we're seeing so many more deaths on our roads.
Yes, fatality-free Friday. We just saw the story there from Alex today. And, wow, this is a hard habit to break, isn't it? It's really, really difficult, especially if you're in a car that isn't tech-driven, if it doesn't have Bluetooth, if it doesn't have, you know, the video screen there that is not going to transcribe that text into spoken text. It's so difficult to be sitting there driving home and you get the text, don't look down, don't look down. It's really, really difficult to do. And how important is it for a lot of us in that situation that we're supposed to be answering that text? It could be as simple as your partner. They want to know what time you're going to be home for dinner, you know, and then it causes you, if you're not going to look down, you then have to pull over. You have to get out of the flow of traffic. You may be on a highway, etc. This is a really difficult situation, I think, that we're in at the moment, because obviously smartphones, they're not going to go away and we're always going to be tempted, and it is so easy to do. So this is going
to be... That's why we need the crackdown.
..a very long campaign, I think.
Yeah, I mean, like, nearly 1,200 people died across our country so far this year on our roads. Breeny, it's just shocking. But, you know, back in the 70s it was the drink driving, but that's no longer socially acceptable. But the modern problem is this distracted driving, and no matter how high the penalties go, the message just doesn't seem to be getting through.
That's right, Belinda, and I think it's because of what Gavin said. This isn't simple. Like, the desire to pick up that phone when you've got a text and you're driving is so large, and this is complex. Now, you talked about the death level in the 1970s. Yes, drink driving was a large factor. So was the poor standard of cars. Cars have got so much safety now, and now we've got all these deaths notwithstanding the safety, and phones are the key reason. Now, Gav mentioned the technology in the cars. Yes, it's great, but it also makes you believe that you can do anything in a car. I can do this, I can change channels, I can do whatever I want, I can have this on, and I think cars
have
got...
You don't just have to focus on the driving.
That's right. There's enough distractions in the car, then you think a phone, that's nothing else. Belinda, you and I sit near each other in the newsroom. We've had this discussion several times. The way I do it for myself is I've still got a child seat in the back of my car. I put my phone in there. So
yeah,
I get in the car, I throw it over...
Reach.
Into. Yeah, so it's out of my reach, because I feel as though I'm a responsible driver. I'm 50 years of age. I've hardly racked up a point, a driving offence in my life, my entire career of driving.
And we often have the kids in the car.
Yeah, that's right. So what I do is I've just got to keep that phone away from myself, because Gavin was 100% right. The temptation is massive.
Yeah. OK, we've got to get on to our next topic, and Rugby League State of Origin between New South Wales and Queensland kicks off next week. And Anthony Mundine is calling for players to support a boycott of the Australian national anthem. Aboriginal Blues stars Cody Walker and Josh Addo-Carr have already confirmed that they will not be singing the anthem before the opening game. Mundine, a former New South Wales player, told Nine's Wide World of Sports that support from white players would enormously boost the debate about injustice against Indigenous people. Breeny, you know more about this. There's much more to this story.
Yes, that's right, Belinda. Now, we're getting into very, very dangerous territory here, and I think Anthony Mundine entering this story has put it in dangerous territory. Now, it's not new that the players don't sing the anthem. In the State of Origin series last year, Latrell Mitchell, the big new star on the scene, and Josh Addo-Carr, they didn't sing the anthem in any of the three matches. And you know what? Because it wasn't an issue, nobody noticed. No one even saw that they didn't sing it.
No one even knew.
Yeah, that's right. At the end of the series, I asked them about it. I said, what's going on here? You know, just very quietly and discreetly. And they said, it's not an organised thing. We haven't spoken about it. And they both said the same thing. It's not part of their upbringing. It's not the way they were raised.
They were raised.
The anthem's not part of their life. Yep. They're happy to stand there and honour the fact that their teammates...
Yeah, respect others.
That's right.
Yeah.
They're not taking a knee. It's not any sort of a protest. But it's going to turn into one if we allow Anthony Mundine and these people to get involved in the debate. Well, and I think the NRL, I truly believe, has got a problem on their hands here, Belinda.
Well, Gav, I mean, what do you think? Mundine, he says the song's racist. Is he just stirring up trouble? Quickly.
Just as quickly as I can, I, as a white Australian, I've never looked at the song as being racist, but Mundine made me read the original Australia Fair poem from beginning to end for the very first time. And if you look at it from a different angle, from an Indigenous point of angle, wow, it opens your eyes somewhat. And let's not forget, in 1983, it was also sexist, but we changed it in 1984 to include women.
Well, I think, as you mentioned, Brini, I think it's all about respect. And if you want to sing it or if you don't want to sing it, then it all comes down to respect. And an author has shared her tips for marital bliss, including, my favourite, don't think your spouse is out to get you or irritate you. Brini, so does that mean when you leave the plates next to the sink rather than putting in the dishwasher that you guys aren't trying to irritate us?
Okay. This is going to be a he and she thing. No, I can see this coming
a mile. No, but you and Lizzie, you've notched up how many years? What tips do you have?
Well, we've been married for 16 and we've been together for 24 years. My wife and I don't irritate each other at all. Like, honestly, I think perfect marriages come down to respect between two partners.
I agree with that, totally.
Yeah, and you know what? There's some nights when, I should finish the dishes off before I go to bed, but some nights I'm so stuffed, I say, I'll sort this in the morning, and she knows I will, and I sort it in the morning. And I think that goes through many, many issues in the household, and it all comes down to respect and whether you want to be together. Like, you know,
yes.
Like, when I finish work on a Friday, do I want to go to the pub and watch footy, or do I want to go home? I want to go home, Belinda.
Yeah. This author joked as well, saying that they're still together, her and her partner, of, what, 28 years or something, because they've never asked for a divorce on the same day. But, Gav, I mean, what relationship advice do you have for us all? Another one was, don't put your children before your other half, and do have separate bank accounts. Does that work?
Yeah, well, look, it was a great article and there's some fantastic advice in there. We fight about money, we fight about our children. So many things change during the lifetime of a relationship. And I think the best thing you can possibly do is not always be looking out, not trying to change your partner, but looking back at yourself. What are the parts about you that you can change to just better yourself and therefore help better the relationship? And that in turn helps you to listen to your partner when they're trying to point out your faults. You go, okay, righto, fair enough.
Yeah. And listening, that's a good one too, Gav. That's a good one. Okay, yeah, we've got to get on to the last topic. And could the war on waste see the return of the humble hanky? Gav, we've stopped using plastic bags and straws. Should tissues be next on the list?
Look, this is interesting. With the problems of the future, should be we looking at some of the solutions of the past? My father still uses a handkerchief, and it got me thinking about some of the things that were happening when I was a child and that my parents and grandparents did. Getting the brown paper bag for your groceries back then, it wasn't fantastic. Sometimes it broke, but my grandmother, she had the string bags that she would recycle back
then. Which are back in fashion.
The milk bottle, yep. We, you know, I mean, you had it delivered, filled
Gav,
up with milk.
I've got to get to Brini, sorry. Brini, would you support a resurgence of the handkerchief?
I got one word for you. Never.
Well, that was lucky that it was one word because we are running out of time. Thank you both, gentlemen. Have a great weekend.
Cheers.
Bye.
Good afternoon.